It's Wrestling Observer Radio for Wednesday, May the 20th, 2020. I'm Jim Valley, along with Dave Meltzer, and following the season finale of The Dark Side of the Ring, joining us now is Dr. Martha Hart.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, Martha, I want to thank you for doing the show, obviously. And I guess we'll start just, you saw the show last night, and I saw it twice. I watched it again at 1 in the morning after I contacted you about it. But what's kind of like your thoughts now that you've seen it?
Well, you know, it was very emotional for sure. And although, you know, I'd had a hand in just helping sort of shape the episode, I definitely didn't have creative control. And so I was really pleased that that Vice Media and the producers of Dark Side of the Ring, Evan Husney and Jason Eisner, they took the story in a direction that, you know, I hoped that they would, but I wasn't sure how the story would actually end up turning out. But I was so pleased with it. And actually, it's a story that really should have been told a long time ago. And it's a story that I wanted out there for a long time. But, you know, and I've had different people approach me in the past with very good intentions, but they could just never get the project off the ground. And, you know, and a lot of it was because the WWE and Vince McMahon, you know, they're a powerhouse, and they have very deep pockets, and they have a lot of influence in the entertainment world. And so no one ever wanted to tackle the project because, you know, always worried about going up against them. But then Vice Media came along, and they are such a powerhouse in the entertainment world. And they weren't worried about that. And this is the first time, actually, that I've had that opportunity to really tell my side of the story in a big way and visually, because, of course, I wrote my book in very early days, and everything is in my book. But, you know, I understand that not everybody will read my book. And so this is really nice to be able to see it on the screen and have that level of impact. And just before I forget, to just one thing, I really want to thank everyone that participated in the episode. And I was so pleased that they were open to sharing their experiences and their side of the story, which really helped consolidate, you know, what I've always said. And I really appreciated that. I appreciated that Jim Ross and Jim Cornette and Jimmy the referee and the Godfather and D'Lo and, of course, Chris Jericho all came on and, you know, and spoke so eloquently about their experiences and how it's affected them over the years. And I can't even express how much I appreciated that they did that. And it really helped because, of course, you know, I can tell the story, but it was so nice to hear their side of things. You know, and a lot of them were actually there that night. So that really added to the detail and, you know, and just how impactful losing Owen was. And so I was really pleased about that. And one thing I should mention, too, just before I forget, there's a scene, too, where, you know, of course, when Owen died and I went to Kansas City, I'd gone up on the catwalk on my very first trip there, and I walked right to the spot where Owen fell. And then when the case, you know, was completed and I took my children to Kansas City, I took them to Kemper Arena and I took them up to the catwalk. And there's a space on the catwalk where you can walk, where you're not sort of suspended over the arena. And that's where I took them. I didn't take them right into the center of the arena, just so people know, because, you know, I am a parenting researcher after all, and so I wouldn't take my kids and put them at risk by, you know, letting them walk all the way, you know, across the catwalk. But just to make that clarification.
Yeah, you know, the piece really affected me more, and I was, you know, I was ready for it more than I expected, especially because it's like you have memories of certain things, and I have a lot of suppressed memories of that day. just because it was such a, you know, just everything that happened in that day, it brought it all back, and it was just so tragic, you know, for the lack of a better word. And I think Jim Ross being on it really hit it for me, because I just remember the moment actually before he said that Owen was dead, and I was on the phone, and I don't know, you know, how well you know Marcy Engelstein. I'm sure you know the name anyway. I was actually on the phone with her at that moment, and Brett was on the Brett was on a flight to Los Angeles, so nobody could contact Brett. And I just remember, and I was talking to so many people, and so many people were in denial, and so many people who loved Owen that were not in WWE at the time, what's going on? And, you know, they just, it has to be a work, it has to be an angle. And I go, it's not an angle. He's legitimately in the hospital. And, you know, and people were like, Terry Funk and I had I don't want to say argument, but it was, it's a work. It's got to be a work. And I go, Terry, it's, I promise you, it's not a work. It's got to be. He was in tears. He was just trying to convince him. He didn't believe it, but he was trying to convince himself, because he couldn't handle it. You know, none of us really could. You had to deal with so much from the death of your husband, and then immediately, you know, you had to suck it up, so to speak. And I thought it was really something, that statement that you made about you could have gone one way or the other, you know, one way and just, you know, fallen off the edge, so to speak, or the other way, which is fight. And, you know, you had to fight this, you know, there were so many aspects of that fight that I don't think people really can truly understand. I can't say that I can, but I know about it, you know, between fighting WWE and then, you know, the family situation, and then the way that whole case came down. And in the end, I know you wanted the court, I know you wanted it in court, I know you wanted the evidence out, and then it just wasn't going to happen. And you know, I mean, you turned it into a positive in a big way. But still, I mean, at this point, now that we're 21 years later, 20 years later since, you know, that the thing was settled, I mean, are you happy that it was settled, or do you still have that lingering thing, you know? I mean, and I know it's not the money at this point, but just that lingering thing in you of, we didn't get it to the court, so to speak.
Well, you know, there was so much to this case that I think, you know, people, I don't know if they really understood just the egregious negligence that was involved in this case. And if you look at how, you know, the WWE had hired really top quality riggers in the past. There was a fellow, his name was Joe Branham, and he'd rigged Owen before. And, you know, when a proper rigger does a stunt, there's two things that they always make sure of, that there's redundancy and that the talent never has control of the stunt. So neither of these things were done in Owen's situation. You know, there was no redundancy. And on top of that, they were saying, you know, you don't pull this cord until you get to here. And, you know, and that's just so inappropriate. Then on top of that, the equipment that was used was completely inappropriate. The harness that that was used in the stunt, it was a stunt harness, but it was meant for dragging people behind a car. It wasn't meant to suspend someone 80 feet above the ground. And so what was happening to Owen as he was sitting in the harness was he was actually, you know, he couldn't breathe, and it was cutting off the circulation as he was suspended there. And then, of course, the ridiculous clip that was used, that was a clip that was meant for the sole use of sailboats It, by its very design, it was designed to fail in this type of a stunt, for sure, because the design of the clip is it's meant to release on load. So the fact that Owen was hanging on the clip made it even that much more likely that it would open spontaneously. And I know in the episode, you know, I have the clip and I showed the clip because people should see that this clip, when I said it was the equivalent of a paper clip, I meant it. And you could see how, you know, flimsy and just inappropriate it was. And again, it's not meant for human use. It's meant for the, you know, use on a sailboat. So there was, you know, there was this whole issue of the most inappropriate equipment used, unqualified riggers. And all this was done to have this, you know, this effect where as soon as Owen hit the ground, then he would be quickly released. And then he could just go on and wrestle. But the WWE, they've been told before that, you know, this isn't a safe way to do the stunt. And qualified riggers like Joe Branham said, no, you know, we don't do it that way and we won't do it. And then on top of it, you know, they didn't like that top quality riggers, they're pricey too, they're expensive. So they cut costs and they tried to do a stunt that was, you know, they were pushing for a stunt that wasn't safe to do. And Owen, you know, working for a billion-dollar company, never, ever questioned his safety. He thought, there's, you know, of course this billion-dollar company is going to make sure that I'm safe at a minimum. And of course, that wasn't the case. The other thing that I think people never realized is that, you know, how ugly this fight was for me against the WWE. They are a massive company. They have very deep pockets. And they were going to stop at nothing to try to intimidate me and, you know, just chop me off at the knees. And so, you know, throughout that, the process, what they've done is they decided that they were going to sue me in Connecticut for breach of Owen's contract because in Missouri, where we'd filed the wrongful death lawsuit, they award punitive damages. And they were very worried, the WWE, about the punitive damages. If the case had gone to trial, that was a big concern for them. So they were suing me in Connecticut to try to evade this, you know, scenario where they would have to pay punitive damages, because in Connecticut, they don't allow punitive damages. And so I had to actually go and hire a whole legal team in Connecticut and fight that lawsuit at the same time that I was fighting the wrongful death lawsuit in Missouri. So that was just beyond the pale that they would then sue me, the widow, you know, for breach of Owen's contract when this wasn't about Owen's contract. I wasn't suing them over Owen's contract because they had a stipulation in the contract that all lawsuits had to be taken up against them had to be in Connecticut. But, you know, that's not what I was suing them about. I wasn't suing them for breach of Owen's contract. So anyway, that was, you know, definitely one of the first salvos that they'd thrown at me. But then also to, you know, it was so heartbreaking, the manipulation of the Hart family, because then that resulted in some of the members working against me, stealing legal documents and giving them to the defense. And it was like they had our playbook, you know, and the betrayal that I felt, you know, it was very crushing for me. And then other members, they were silent, and that was equally painful in a lot of ways. So, you know, I now looking back at it, of course, you know, like I've said many times, that, you know, I've forgiven them all. I wish they'd had the strength to stand with me in that fight, but, you know, they didn't, and that's really unfortunate. But I want to say that, you know, I forgave them all a long time ago, and we've all moved on and got, like, me and my children have moved in a very positive direction. But, you know, I really do wish them all the best, because I know how tough life can be and how hard it can be, and I wouldn't wish that on anybody. I don't wish harm on anybody. I truly hope that life has been very kind to all of them. But at the same time, you know, I think it was important that people know this story, and I'm really happy that, like, people have that. I think they get that message that, you know, how awful this story was. I want them to take away too that, you know, there's positive things in this story too. And a lot of that comes through the good work that we do through the Owen Hart Foundation. And that is the true spirit of Owen, you know, just everything the Owen Hart Foundation does is just a reflection of what a wonderful person he was. And I'm glad that people got to see that. And I'm really happy with the episode that, you know, everybody knew Owen as the wrestler. And that's okay, but this episode really gave them a window into the man, the person that he was. And you can see from watching the episode that, you know, how lovely he was and how happy, and we had this very happy life. And it was, you know, he was just such a terrific person, and everybody loved him. And, you know, so it's nice that people got to see that. And I was really happy for the fans too, because, you know, Owen loved his fans. He was actually, I bet you out of any wrestler, maybe out of any entertainer, he had such a good relationship with his fans, because a lot of the fans, he actually befriended, you know, they'd pick him up and they'd, you know, pick him up at the airport. And he loved people, and he, you know, he loved real people. He loved genuine people. And he just spent a lot of quality time with his fans. And so he never had that sort of, like, you know, perspective that there was this barrier that, you know, I'm over here, you're over there. He just looked at everyone as a person, you know, and he thought everyone had value. And that's how he approached people. So I think because he was so approachable and so likable, you know, it was easy. And he honestly enjoyed spending time more with the fans than he did definitely than with the people that he worked for.
What was your emotions like, and the decision making of going to mediation, settling? Because, I mean, any lawyer would tell you to settle. That's kind of like what lawyers do.
Yeah,
but at the same time, your motivation was very different from most people who are involved in a case like this. And I've been told that kind of from, you know, I mean, and I think to an extent, Brett, too. You know, I know, because Brett was very supportive at that time in your life. I mean, this thing, to me, in a sense, almost started at Owen's funeral, because it turned into a television event. And I think that mm-hmm. was exactly what you didn't want. I mean, I remember from that mm-hmm. period was like, I watched the thing on television, and at the same time, I had already been told that you did not want this thing on television, and there it was.
Yeah, I know. Well, this was always the problem with the WWF at the time, now E, was the incredible lack of respect for Owen and for me. And, you know, and you're right, well, it started even before the funeral, because, of course, you know that when Owen fell to his death and he died in the ring, they just scooped him up like he was a piece of garbage and hauled him out of there. And then they paraded match after match onto a canvas that had Owen's blood, but also the boards under the ring were broken. And there was a dip in the ring, and the wrestlers could feel where the dip was. You know, and so, again, just that lack of, you know, regard for human life. That was just the first sign of what I was dealing with. And then at the funeral too, you know, I had invited them. I wanted them to come. I wanted Vince McMahon and his family to come. I promised Vince that, you know, if he was to come, that I would treat him with respect, and, you know, that he didn't have to worry. I wanted him there. But I requested, please don't take any footage of the funeral. Just come as a guest, because I've invited you and I've invited your company. And And I stuck to my word. I greeted him. I was pleasant to him. And then that night, you know, all I saw was footage of the funeral all over his show, and they were making money off of it. And, you know, then it just, all their decisions were so bad, so poor, you know, right from the start, just getting Owen off the ring and just making sure they didn't have to stop the show to, you know, because they didn't want to be at risk of losing a single penny. And then, you know, making sure that they had their camera crews there to get that footage and broadcast it and make more money. And, you know, that's all they cared about was money, money, money. And yet they couldn't even spend the money to make sure that Owen was rigged properly. So, you know, all the way through, the lack of respect, and then on top of it, how awful they were to me, you know, suing me and manipulating Owen's family. And it was just so awful, all of it. So, you know, there's just so many layers. And then, you know, even on top of it, I remember that they had gone to the newspaper and they said that they paid for Owen's funeral, which they did not. They paid to come to the funeral, like every other person, but they certainly didn't pay for Owen's funeral. So again, it was, you know, just this constant, you know, and I'll tell you, WWE, they are a PR powerhouse. You know, they could get their message out fast and quick, and it was like lightning. I'm one individual too, you know, and I'm from Canada, and you can imagine the fight that I had in Connecticut and in Missouri, and I'm all the way from Canada, so that was a lot of work for me always to be traveling to these places, and I went to every deposition. I sat through every deposition. The only one I didn't sit through was the medical examiner. But I read every affidavit. I studied everything about this case. You know, and it wasn't about money for me ever. I've always wanted to go to trial because I wanted accountability. You know, I wanted the truth to be known. I wanted that out there. And, you know, as we sort of went through the lawsuit and all the WWE was always trying to do was just muddy the waters, get away from the actual case of what actually happened. And they were doing a good job of it because they were, you know, detracting from the case, like with these, you know, sort of like red herrings, like, oh, we're going to sue her over here, and that'll, like, then they'll have to deal with that, and we'll manipulate the family, and then they'll have to deal with that, and just making it such a mess. And so then what was happening, because my lawyers, you know, like you said, normally lawyers, they think, well, this will settle. My lawyers were trial lawyers, but, you know, of course, as a lawyer, they always are hoping that, you know, they can resolve the case and they don't have to go to trial. And my lawyers were no different. They were always approaching me and saying, you know, about like, gee, like, should we put a number on the table? And I told them, in no uncertain terms, don't even ever bring that up to me. And they knew that my mindset was that, no, we are on the road to trial and there's nothing else. There's nothing that's going to stop us from achieving that goal. And so, but the problem is that even if you go to trial, you should put a number on the table, because when you do that, then the interest starts running. And so my problem was, because I told my lawyers, never, we're never putting a number on the table. So then the defense, they could delay. They kept delaying because they had nothing to lose, right? So, and this is what my lawyers were saying, like, and then I thought, geez, it's almost like, you know, they're laughing at me because I won't put this number on the table, and they can just afford to delay forever. They have the deepest pockets. They can drag this on forever. So then as a strategy, I said to my lawyers, let's put a number on the table, which was a very extremely hard decision for me. But I said, I'm only doing it as a strategy to stop them from delaying this case. And so we put the number on the table. And so what happens is they'll have 60 days to accept that like number as a settlement. And if they don't, then once they don't, then it's like the you know, the timer starts ticking then. It's like now you're accruing interest on that amount that's been put on the table. So when we got to the 60th day, you know, I never thought they'd accept the number we put, but then I got worried and I panicked because I thought, oh my God, like, what if they actually accept it and then we settle and then this is over and where's my justice? And, you know, because again, you know, I had this mindset that we needed to go to trial. And that's what I was thinking, that, you know, I've gone through all this and where's my justice going to be? Because I looked at settlement like a failure. You know, it's like, no, this needs to go to trial. Like anything less than that is a failure. So then I phoned my lawyer and I said, I'm worried. What if they accept this? Then where's my justice? And she said something that just shook me to my core and something that I didn't ever even think of. And she said to me, Martha, at the end of the day, no matter how this thing ends, it's always only going to be about money. And I said, what? And then she said, well, you know, no one's going to jail. Nobody gets convicted at the end of it. This is all it's about is money. And when she said that, you know, I never thought of it that way because I always just was thinking, I want to go to trial. I want justice for Owen. I want accountability. And when she said that, I never felt such despair in my life that, you know, I thought all this work, everything I've done, this is all it's about is just money. At the end of the day, it's just going to be a check. That's it. And so then at the same moment when I literally was at the bottom of the barrel, then I don't even know where it came to me, but I was just like a flash of light. I was like, you know what? I know what I'm going to do with this money. I am going to start a foundation and I'm going to create my own justice. If I can't get the justice I'm seeking through the legal system, I will create my own form of justice and it's going to be beautiful and it's going to be bright and it's going to be positive and it's going to reflect everything that Owen was. And I thought, like, I don't know anything about starting a foundation at all, but that's what I'm going to do. When this is all said and done, I'm going to take that money and I'm going to start this foundation and that's going to be my justice. You know, like, success is the best revenge, right? And so then, you know what, it was like a weight had been lifted off of me because I thought, no matter how this ends, whether we go to trial or if it's settled, then I know what I'm doing after this. And so then it just changed my view and it made it okay that I could settle this case. And then because then I was like, I know what I want to do. I want to do something so great and I'm going to create the most beautiful thing. So that's what happened. And then you're right, like you mentioned Brett, and he was very supportive, and I always appreciated that. I still appreciate it to this day. With Brett, we had, you know, through the lawsuit, he wasn't friends with Vince at the time. He was like in a big battle against him over the whole Montreal thing. And he had come to us and, you know, was asking if we settled this case ever, like that we could get his wrestling footage included in the settlement, which was, you know, an odd request, but I didn't think that was even possible. But, you know, I appreciated his help and you know, I wished I could have helped him back. But when that didn't happen, because of course this case was about Owen's life and death and the negligence, and it wasn't about Brett's footage. But when that didn't happen, then Brett got very upset with me. And it was hard, you know. I remember I cried when he yelled at me about it. And you know, if I could have helped him, I would have, because to this day, you know, I always appreciated that he helped me, and he did help me, and it meant a lot. But then after that, I think his footage mattered so much to him because, you know, he wanted that legacy and you know, and he was a very good wrestler, and I knew that wrestling was, you know, such a big part of his life. And so anyway, as it turned out, then he went and befriended Vince You know, and he did tell me once, he said, you know, if I ever befriended Vince again, my soul would shatter. And, you know, but then, like, then that's what he did, because he wanted that footage and he wanted that legacy. And, but then, and that's fine. It's like, you know, and he could have done that and, you know, got his footage or whatever, but then it just seemed like he sort of started turning, like he turned towards Vince, but he turned against me. And then it became sort of this, this battle where then he was trying to be an advocate for the WWE and, you know, really pushing to get Owen into their Hall of Fame, which, you know, I always said, like, that's never going to happen because this is the company is responsible for his death. And not only that, the just the level of disrespect that they've continued to show, like, from start to finish, it just, it wasn't going to happen, you know. So that's the unfortunate story with Brett, that, you know, things really shifted with him. And, you know, but again, you know, Brett, he really helped me, and I don't care what his agenda was. I'm always going to be grateful that he did help me, and I wish the best for him too. But, you know, you can forgive people, and I have, like I said, forgiven them all. But that doesn't mean that you have to have a relationship with them. And, you know, I see the Hart family, and when I do, I'm always polite. And, you know, this was a family I cared about at one time, and, you know, and I still care about them. And I still wish the best for them. So, you know, and I tell my kids that too, that, you know, if you see them, you be polite and you be respectful. Because I think no matter what people do in life, you should always, you know, just, it doesn't hurt to be nice to people regardless. And, you know, at the end of the day, what's done is done. And unfortunately, the damage is done and it's irreparable. We can't have a relationship because, you know, like any relationship in life, once you break the trust, you have to have trust in order to have a relationship. So you know, that's, like I said, it's sort of the casualties of war, and it's just unfortunate that it all happened that way. And but the whole story is unfortunate, you know. And I mean, I think because I like to look at the positives, and I think there are still a lot of positives, and definitely the Owen Hart Foundation is a huge positive.
Kind of tell us about the Owen, you know, the goals of the Owen Hart Foundation, and the fact that, you know, you used the settlement money to help people get into homes, get into colleges, things like that.
Well, you know, education was always really important to me and Owen. And so that's sort of like, I thought, well, I want to make that our mandate, education, and have it sort of be the umbrella of the foundation, because you can fit a lot of things under that umbrella. And so we have three signature programs. So we provide scholarships to individuals in need. And then also we have a housing component where we help people to purchase homes. So we literally give them the down payment to purchase a home, but they have to go through a 2-year financial literacy program, just so they can learn how to, like, budget and, you know, save their money and what home ownership means. And, you know, there's a lot to owning a home too, you know, and how to budget for all the things that can happen, like when you own a house, things breaking down, whatever. But so then we have that component. And then we also have a partnership component, which is amazing, because I love to collaborate with other organizations. And so we've been able to do so many great things. We help schools all over the world. We partner with For the Love of Children Society. We partner with Amnesty International. We partner with the Calgary Zoo. Like, we just have endless partnerships, and they're fantastic. We love the partnerships. So we're able to do so much good. And, you know, my son, he's a lawyer, and he's doing his master's in international law in England, but he's back in Canada now because of COVID. But he wants to pursue human rights law. And so we have a whole like portion of the foundation that really reflects that. So, you know, that's where we partner with Amnesty International. But then my daughter, she's a journalism graduate, and she writes for this really cute animal magazine. She has an animal humanitarian column in the magazine. But so we have a component too where we really support animal rights. So we partner with the Calgary Zoo. They have a conservation program, and you know, so it's nice because I had kind of like basic needs interests, right? And even we have a fund at the Alberta Children's Hospital where, you know, we help families with basic needs. Like if they go to the hospital with their sick children, but they don't have the money for a hotel or for food, or, you know, our fund takes care of things like that, basic needs. So I was always sort of about like, I want to help people like at the ground level. But then, you know, my kids came to me and they were like, you know, Mom, there's so many other really great causes, like, you know, my son with the human rights and my daughter with like her animal rights and even the environment, such a big, you know, cause right now, and all really amazing. So we've kind of expanded our vision. Again, it's all about education because, you know, education is power. You inform people, and, you know, and it's even like getting back full circle to our episode, you inform people and you show them, you know, and then they know, you know, once you know, you know. And so, I think education in all forms, whether it's sort of academic or in trades or whatever, it's such a positive thing. And you can never go wrong, you know, being educated in any form. So we really support that. And that's sort of like our, like I said, our umbrella. And, you know, and that's the nice thing too, I'll just mention about our scholarship program. We give bursaries, and my whole thrust was that we lowered the bar. So if kids in high school, if they get into any program, they can apply for the scholarships. So we don't make it where it's the most scholastic kids, because the whole point was to encourage kids that, you know what, yes, you can go to university and you can get scholarships to go, even if you're not getting 90s in school. If you just even get accepted into anywhere, even a trade school or art school or anywhere, you know, then that's great. And we will support you. So the scholastic kids are always going to find scholarships. They will. It's the kids that are just, you know, right, like at the bar, that they have a hard time finding funding. And that's a shame because, you know, lots of kids too these days, they have to work, you know, they work part time or they help their families. And if they have a job, then they can't dedicate all their time to studying. So they're not the kids that are going to get the 90s, not that they couldn't, but they just don't have the time. So we really wanted to catch those kids like a safety net, you know, and be able to say like, yeah, we got you. And, you know, you go to school and, you know, get your education and you can do it. So it's about not just rewarding the best, but it's about encouraging others to, you know, reach their full potential.
When you look back, the stuff with Oja and the trains and everything, you know, it's just, you know, in many ways heartbreaking, because I think one of the things in wrestling is there've been a lot of tragedies in wrestling. Not as many in the last few years, but there was a period from, you know, for decades where there were, you know, it was one after the other. And Owen's, you know, to me, Owen was always like the different one, because so many of them were, you know, drug-induced and things like that, or party induced or whatever, which, you know, and Owen was not that guy. And Owen's situation was, you know, 100% unavoidable. It was a stunt that had no business. It never should have been done. When it was done, it was negligent. It served no purpose. You know, whatever the motives were bad motives anyway. And then, you know, everyone, you know, I've known from other families that have gone through this, you know, that everyone, you know, they're sad about the wrestler and this and that, but they don't realize that so many of them left young kids behind. And, you know, when I saw, you know, Oge, you know, again, at 7, you're going to remember stuff, and you have the footage and everything. And it was really, really was a heartbreaker. And with Athena, you know, at 3, right, when Owen died, I mean, it's like, I mean, I couldn't even remember anything in three. And I mean, it's just so, you know, and Owen, you know, you could see, and I knew him a little bit, as you know. He was a fun guy. He was a good-hearted guy. I was actually, the first time he was in WWE as the Blue Blazer, so this would be like the late 80s. I think I was with him the night that he decided to quit because he was in his hotel room with me and one of my friends, who was a better friend of Owen's than I was, when he called Stu and pretty much told Stu, you know, that you know, he was going to quit, and he was, you know, kind of talking to us about going to Japan, you know, and wrestling in Japan, and that was kind of like what he wanted to do, and he wasn't really happy in WWF at the time. And a funny story is his own often room with the Ultimate Warrior, and he was telling us, like, funny Ultimate Warrior stories and everything. And Ultimate Warrior was like, you know, how about, you know, like, you know, like, you know, could I go too? You know, which is funny because Ultimate Warrior had so much success about a year later, and was already on that verge already. He was already a big star in WWF by that time. And Owen was like, because Ultimate Warrior was not a great wrestler. Owen was obviously a fantastic wrestler. And he just goes, you know, Jim, you know, Japan's not for everybody. You know, trying to, you know, tell him, you know, kind of like, you know, it probably wouldn't be best for you, but it is best for me. But Jim was very much, you know, interested in going to Japan, and, you know, which is just an interesting footnote in wrestling history, because I remember when that all went down. But, you know, like, you know, I just felt so bad for your daughter, especially in the sense of, you know, she had this dad who loved her, who was a great guy, you know, and you know, she was robbed of all the things that people expect, you know, that kids grow up with a cool dad, you know. So yeah. that was like really heartbreaking to me watching the show last night.
Well, you know, for me as a parent, I think that's the saddest thing for me is that, you know, when something terrible happens in your life as an adult, you go through it, and it's sort of situational. You know, you go through that hardship, but then, you know, you recover, and you hopefully come out of it better. But with kids, when something so traumatic happens to them, that has lifelong effects, you know? And so that, for me as a parent, is the saddest thing. And, you know, what also is sad is when I look back when Owen was here and we were a family, and, you know, I was such a happy mom, and, you know, and then when Owen died, it changed, because then it was just me. And so then, you know, you carry all that worry, because I always thought, well, you know, I have to make sure that these kids turn out good, because it's all on my shoulders, you know, that if they don't, then it's going to be all on me, because I'm all they got. And, you know, and that was a really hard thing, too, because sure, they lost their dad, but then also, too, my attention was divided, you know, when I had to go through the whole court case and everything, and not to mention, you know, how sad I was about everything that I was dealing with too. So it was really hard to, you know, and I really tried to make sure that the kids didn't like necessarily see that side, but at the same time, you know, I didn't want to, let them think everything was okay either, because it wasn't. And so they were aware that things weren't good and all of that too. But that's the hard part too for me, is that, you know, and I know this just because I'm that's my job in real life. That's my doctor hat that I wear, is, you know, I'm a parenting researcher. So I know that kids, they'll like, if you have two great parents, that's the ultimate thing, you know. And but, you know, you can have one great parent and that will get you through, and I know that too. So but, you know, that's the hard part for me, is that I know that, like, my kids, their lives would have been different. And you know, I think that they would have similar personalities, but, you know, everything affects people. You are, you know, what your whole childhood is too. It's all rooted in, it's all into how you develop and shape and everything. But they were robbed of that. They were robbed of of having a wonderful dad, because he was an amazing father. And, you know, it's sad to lose a parent, but it's just tragic to lose a wonderful parent. And he was, and he was such a great dad. He loved being a dad. He loved all the kid stuff. You know, he was like a big kid. It was like having three kids, because, you know, he loved to play, and he was always like, that was for him, that was golden time, was spending time with the kids. And that was our life. You know, we did everything with our kids. We took them everywhere. You know, we never went on a trip without our kids. We took them even as babies. Oh, just first trip, he was just 4 weeks old. We went to Indianapolis. And, you know, and Athena too, like, we traveled all the time with the kids. We took them everywhere, to Germany. Well, and you saw the footage of Oj in Japan, you know,
right,
so
footage,
they
yeah,
were like, you know, yeah, there was no divide, you know, we were like a united family. And, you know, and then, and I'm glad that they, like, Oj really has a lot of memories with his dad. And because he was that much older, and, you know, he really, like, things stuck. And because we, you know, we had such good quality time, and maybe too, because Owen, you know, he wasn't there all the time. So then Oj really has vivid memories of, you know, the time that he did spend with dad, because that was precious. And Athena, unfortunately, you know, she was so young that she does have some memories, and she definitely remembers, you know, her dad with all the animals. And it's just funny how she's such an animal lover. She always was. She just always loved animals so much. But, like, so it's nice that that's what sticks out to her, is, you know, all the animal stuff. And, you know, and it's funny, that little clip of her on the horse, because then when she got older, she actually was an equestrian rider, and she was really great at riding. So, but now she's kind of shifted. Now she's kind of like, well, I don't know if the horse really wants me on its back. So, you know, but at the time she was a great rider when she was, like, you know, in high school and stuff. So
for you, I mean, like, a lot, so much of this, I mean, when I look at the situation from you lost a lot. I mean, you know, you have the memories of a certain number of years, but, you know, when it comes, you know, let's face it, you know, you were robbed of a lot. I mean, you know, you can kind of, like, the kids are robbed of a lot, but you were robbed of, you know, whatever it is, 40 years, 50 years, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And that's got to be, you know, I mean, it's, yeah. You know, I don't know how to say it nicely, but, you know, I'm just trying to put myself kind of in your shoes. And it never should have happened. You know, I mean, that's the other thing.
Yeah.
It's you know, from your situation, you couldn't let it be the tragedy, but it was, without a doubt.
Yeah. No, it really was. And I guess, you know, like I'd mentioned in the documentary, that, you know, when I lost Owen, it was so devastating. But at the same time, it's like, well, I can't let everything that we had be for nothing. You know, I can't just let everything fall apart. Now, we had all these goals and all these dreams, and you know, and I guess, for me, I had sort of two separate lives, because I had a life when Owen was home, but then I had a life when he wasn't home too. And so then that's like, it was lucky for me that I could just go into full mode when, you know, because I was already used to not having him all the time. And, but it was so hard, because the thing was that, you know, when he wasn't home, it was all just the work stuff, you know, it's like, just get all the tasks done. When Owen came home, it was the reward. Like, now it's family time, and now we're together. And then it just went from where I never got any rewards. It was just work, work, work. And you know, even like times when the kids were sick, or, you know, you just needed that extra support and it wasn't there. And that was just heartbreaking. And don't get me crying now, Dave. I'm already emotional. It's been a tough week. But, you know, yeah, like, it was really hard. But, you know, then what I did was I decided that, you know, like, I had other goals that I was working towards too. And I decided that, you know, that's going to be, like, I was working towards other goals that were kind of in slow motion because, you know, I couldn't just go to university full time or things like that, you know, because it's like, well, you have a family and you have, like, you know, other things that need attention. And so then that's what I did. I shifted my focus. And, you know, I was working on my education when Owen died. I was at university. And then I just put so much effort into that because then I decided that, you know, the career that I always wanted, that's going to be my goal. And my kids are going to be my goal. And I thought I only have one shot at being a parent and raising these kids properly. And they're going to get all my attention. I'm not dividing it. It's going to be them. And I'm going to focus on my career. So that's what I did. And I was really lucky that, you know, I got into Cambridge University in England. So we moved to England and we lived there for quite a bit of time because I did my master's and my PhD there. And so that was really a great experience, actually. And it's nice because now Oge actually is in university in the UK, too. So England's like second home for us, for sure. But then, you know, and I was lucky enough, I worked for the University of Cambridge for about a year and a half. But then I wanted to come back home. And I was so lucky that, you know, as soon as I applied to one job at the University of Calgary and I got it, and that's where I've been ever since. And it's wonderful because, you know, now for my career aspirations, I really feel like I've put my signature on the scientific community and our research team, me and my boss, Dr. Letourneau, we actually developed this incredible parenting intervention called ATTACH. And it was funded by Harvard University. And now we just received a very huge grant from the Canadian government to scale the project across Canada. So for me, that's just incredible success, like on a sort of a professional level. And yet, like, it's still wearing that same hat of being able to help people. So I really love that. Like, all my layers in my life all sort of intersect. And another thing I should mention that probably people don't realize is that I'm such a movie lover, and I'm actually the vice president of the Monaco International Film Festival. It's the only film festival in the world. Yeah, and it's the only one in the world that it promotes nonviolence in film. So I love the film festival there, and I actually have a movie blog. And my movie blog, it's a really positive blog, and it talks about, like, it's just a fun thing, but it's, you know, my take on it is find the meaning of life through the movies you watch. So I write about movies. I do like a review of sorts, but what I do is, you know, I say, like, what's the takeaway message of this movie? What does this movie hope you learn about life? Or, you know, so I always, you know, talk about, like, what you should learn by watching this movie. And then I always try to put a little personal element in if I can, like, well, I always do find some common thread with the movie. And it's really fun. And I actually did a review on the docuseries on the, you know, Owen Hart's Final Days. And so I hope people go check it out because, you know, I really think there's, you know, for all the sadness, again, like, there's some really positive life lessons. And, you know, so go check out the movie blog and see what I think the takeaway message is from my own docuseries. So,
I read it. I really enjoyed your analysis of a Groundhog Day. And I thought it was very poignant for everyone's lives right now. So I enjoyed it thoroughly.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, thank you. That is so sweet. So, yeah. Well, you know, I love it and I love to write and it's just really fun. And, you know, I don't rip movies apart because I always think, no, you know what, every movie, even if it's silly or corny or, you know, not well made or whatever, like they have something to say and that's what they're trying to do. Movies is convey a message, you know, what's the message, right? What can you take away?
Well, what was it like? Okay. So I know from when you were in with Chris Jericho and you mentioned one of your and Owen's favorite movies was Father of the Bride, which is an interesting, you know, I mean, but later you know, you had Steve Martin perform for you guys for your foundation, right?
Yeah, we did. And you know what, my daughter, I have to tell you, she did something so sweet. she took the DVD that we had, like, of Father of the Bride, and she had Steve Martin and Martin Short, because we had them both, and they're both in Father of the Bride. So she had them both sign the DVD for me behind my back and as a gift for me. So that was so sweet of her. So I have that, like, in, you know, my little office of memorabilia. But no, you know what? That's the other thing, too, that with the Owen Hart Foundation, every year we do a high-profile entertainer event. And we have had so many amazing guests. So we just had our 20th anniversary, as you know, and we had Jerry Seinfeld for our 20th anniversary. We also had him for our 10th anniversary, and he was so terrific that I said every year, it was kind of a running joke, you know, we need to get Jerry back for the 20th. And so we'd even tell his team, you know, like, don't come to Calgary because we want you back for the 20th, you know. And then, you know, but who knew if he was actually going to, like, still be performing. And you know what? Sure enough, he was. And he came in. He did two shows. We were totally sold out. It was great. But we also have had incredible guests. Like, we had Robin Williams, which, oh, my God, like, that guy, he was so amazing. Oh, we just loved him so much. The realest guy on the planet, like, just incredible. But, you know, we had him. We had Ringo Starr, which I loved Ringo Starr. He was so incredible. And just the life he lived, you know, he's such an icon. And he was just lovely. And, you know, I mean, we have it all on our Owen Hart Foundation website. Like, and I even did these, like, little sort of like blast from the past where I give, like, sort of viewers, like, extra little details about the event. Like, you know, we had Seth Meyers, who was great, and he forgot his passport and he almost missed his flight and we barely got him in time. Like, so I tell, like, little funny stories, you know. But you know, Owen was such a funny guy. And that's the other thing, like, everyone will tell you, like, the prankster he was. And, you know, you brought up Ultimate Warrior, and I have to tell you, Owen would do this little trick on Jim. They'd be on a flight, and Owen would be sitting behind Jim on the plane, and Jim would fall asleep. And, you know, he always, like, had his he'd have not wrestling boots, but, like, cowboy boots on, you know, and he was always, like, looking like the part, right? And so Owen would take the peanuts and he would throw them into Jim's boot while he was sleeping. And then Jim would wake up and his boots would be full of peanuts, and he'd be like, Owen, like, I'm making peanut butter in my boots again because of you, you know. But he would just do these little pranks that were, they were harmless, but you know, he was always just joking around with people and just, you know, like, he was just amused by, you know, kind of pranking people all the time. And it's interesting because I remember saying to him very seriously, like, you know, Owen, you need to stop joking around. And he just looked at me with this funny grin. He's like, I'll really try. And I just thought, you know, what do you mean try? Like, you just don't have to do it. But he couldn't, you know, it was too big of an ask because that's who he was. He just was playful, you know, he's a playful guy. And he just liked to do these little silly pranks. Like I mentioned on Chris Jericho on his show that Owen would, like, take the tea bag, you know, and it's hooked to a little string, and he would take it and he would tape it into the cupboard. And then when I'd open it, it would fly out at me, and he did it because he knew I was, like, terrified of mice. And it was just, you know, like, he would do it just to get all that work, just to get, like, a one-second reaction, you know. And he would do it. He was strategic, you know. He didn't do it all the time. He would just, when I wasn't expecting it, then all of a sudden, you know, the teabag would come flying out of the cupboard at me. But, you know, little things like that. And I have to mention, too, with the Dark Side of the Ring episode, there is an encore presentation. I think they show it in about a week.
It's next Tuesday at 8:30, just for people
next in the U.S. Tuesday at 8:30. So it's worth the watch because there's an added four-minute clip of Owen the Prankster. And everyone, well, not totally everyone, but almost everyone who's in the episode telling a joke that Owen played on them. So I tell it like something he did to me. I won't say it now because I want people to watch it, but it was just priceless. It's a really cute 4-minute clip about Owen the prankster, you know, so it's worth a watch.
When you started dating at 15, did Owen or the family mm-hmm. protect the business around you?
Yeah, you know, at that time, when I dated Owen, wrestling wasn't a big interest, and it so I didn't really ask about it or anything, but I didn't actually know that it was like a setup, because they were really good then about making it real. You know, like those guys, like they should have gotten Oscars for because they were so good at playing their roles of, you know, and making people believe that it was real. And so, I mean, I think people always like sort of suspected, but it's kind of like with boxing or whatever that, you know, like I think people accepted it generally that it was like for real, legit. But then there's always that possibility that with any kind of one-on-one sport, you could always rig it, I suppose, right? So, but yeah, there was a time when, you know, they really followed it through and, you know, they didn't let people know sort of the family secret, right? That the finishes were arranged and things like that.
Do you remember when you got, as they say, smartened up?
Yeah, well, like I do remember it was kind of like there was a conversation and Brett said to Owen, you know, is Martha smart? And then Owen said, no. And then later I said to him, what do you mean, Owen? I'm not some bimbo. I'm actually quite intelligent, you know. And then he had to tell me because, like, I was actually kind of, like, mad at him for thinking I wasn't smart. And then he told me. And it was really nice, actually, because we were at a point, I guess, in our relationship that I took it as, you know, like a real sort of level of trust, that he would trust me with, you know, with that sort of information, right? And, you know, and that's the thing, though, with when I met Owen, you know, we both sort of had a plan that we were going to go to university, and Owen was going to be, he was going to be a school teacher. He wanted to be a phys ed teacher, and that's what he was going to university for. And he was actually, he was a very good athlete, and he was a four-letter like letterman, you know, because he played football and he wrestled and he also did track and field and rugby. But he got a scholarship to University of Wrestling, an amateur wrestling scholarship. And, you know, his dad was such a lover of amateur wrestling. So Owen, you know, out of sort of respect for his dad, and his dad was so proud that, you know, he went to university on the wrestling scholarship. But, you know, university's tough, and when you do a varsity sport, it's even tougher. And so it's hard for him to wrestle and then keep up with his studies as well. So he was in the wrestling business, or he was at university, and this was right around the time when Vince was buying up all the small territories, and they were trying to keep the business going. Owen's brother Bruce was the booker, and so Bruce had come to Owen and said, you know, we're really like struggling, and dad's hemorrhaging money, and we really need some help. And, you know, geez, like you're so athletic and you're young and you're a heart, and, you know, like that would carry a lot of weight. You know, do you think you could come and help dad and just, you know, help him even just for the summer or whatever? So that's what Owen did. That's sort of how he started in the business. And, you know, and of course he was a natural athlete, so he was very good at it. And he, growing up in the wrestling business, he really understood the philosophy and the psychology behind the sport and stuff. So, but his intention wasn't to stay in wrestling as a career. And he was often, like, always trying to get out of it for years. He applied to the fire department every year. And at that time in Calgary, it was really hard to get on the fire department. You had to have a university degree, and he hadn't finished his degree because he'd gone to, you know, help his dad, and then it kind of picked him up and carried him away from his original goals and plans. And so, you know, that was really crushing for Owen, because Owen's brother was a firefighter, and so was his brother-in-law. Yeah. And so he knew that life and he liked it. Like, he thought, that's the perfect life. You know, these guys are great. And it fit with his personality, because Owen was a very kind, caring person, always trying to help people. And it really would have suited him very well. And he was a real sort of social guy. So, you know how firefighters, they work 4 days on, 4 days off. And he would have loved that whole life of, like, living in the fire hall with the guys, but then coming home. And, you know, and he was strong. He was a big, strong guy. So he would have actually made a super wonderful firefighter. But, you know, he never had success. Like, he would get through the initial exams and he'd get to a certain point, but then he never kept past that barrier, because they'd always pick the guys that had, like, university degrees, and that wasn't him. And so then another job that he tried, he was an American citizen and a Canadian citizen, so the dual citizenship. So he applied also at the, to be a customs agent, because in Canada, you know, you have to go through U.S. customs in Canada. So we have American customs agents that live in Canada, and he thought, well, that would be ideal, because he's American as well as Canadian. And he could live in Calgary and work as an American, though. And again, you know, no success. And so it was kind of coming to that point in our life, like, you know, he'd wrestled. It was always a good plan B, because it was a good living, and, you know, it definitely provided a living for us. But he always wanted to sort of escape wrestling. And then it got to a point where he realized, you know, that it just wasn't going to happen anytime soon. So then we embraced it as, like, okay, well, you know, we had a plan, like, he'd work for maybe another 10 years in the business if his body could put up with it. And then when he would be done with it, you know, he really liked to build things, and he loved building bicycles. That was sort of his favorite hobby. And I actually have a bike in my garage right now that he built. And it's the cutest bike. It's purple and it has a basket. And you know, this is what he liked to do. He loved working with all the gears and the pedals, and he would just take scraps and he would just, like, I don't know, it was like magic, you know, he just built a bike with it. And that's what he thought. He would like to maybe open up a shop, and that, you know, he would have a bike shop, and he would just, like, tinker around and fix bikes and do this kind of fun stuff. And we did a lot of biking too. So that was sort of the goal for him. And, you know, that's, like, how life picked him up and took him far away from his original plans, you know.
When did you figure out, or did you see, because I remember Owen, probably from his first week of television, for sure, because I would get the tapes of Stampede Wrestling, and I vividly remember, because when Owen started, he was like the hot new thing in wrestling. You know, he was so talented from day one. I mean, when did you figure out, because, like, you know, I had a group of friends and we would watch, you know, tapes from Japan and everything like that. But the Calgary tapes, I mean, that was one of the things that we would, once a month I'd get a tape and it'd be, you know, four shows. So before Owen Hart main events, this is the first year he was wrestling with his brother-in-law, Ben Bassarab, and Hase, and, you know, you were there, mm-hmm. at that era.
Yeah.
When did, you know, and he was, you know, he started and he was in the main events, I don't know, like, right away. He was the top guy right away. He was, he was so talented. Did you ever watch, like, wrestling with him, like, whether it's Dynamite? Because I would watch him and go, you know, he's emulating Tiger Mask and Dynamite Kid, mm-hmm. and to an extent Brett. And I could watch him and go, like, this guy has studied, but he's also a natural at this. What was the point when, did you figure out how good he was right away, or when did you kind of figure out, oh, you know, he's pretty damn good at this thing?
Well, he like I mentioned, he was a natural athlete. He was good at all sports. So he, you know, and then on top of it, having been, you know, raised in a wrestling family, they had a big wrestling ring in the back garden. And so, you know, he could go and practice and stuff too, but he was a real natural athlete, and he was very acrobatic. And so that really helped his style. And I remember watching tapes with him of Tiger Mask, and he was just, he was a Japanese wrestler that I think he was sort of the first that did this incredible flying, you know, style, and so entertaining to watch. And because Owen was so acrobatic, then he could emulate that style, and he really liked that. And he had incredible matches against Hassi, who is just a very sweet guy on top of being like an exceptional athlete too. Right now is a senator in Japan. Yep. So
actually, he's actually now in the cabinet, in Shinzo Abe's cabinet.
So he's surprised.
The Minister of Sports Education, Technology, I forget all of them, but those are three of them. I mean, he's a real major guy in the Japanese political world.
You know, I'm not surprised at all, because Hassi was a really bright guy. And so, you know, and he and Owen were good friends. And so they had really great matches. And I was lucky enough to get to go with Owen a couple of times to Japan.
I understand you have a pro wrestling tea store with new Owen Hart t-shirts.
Yes, exactly. No, I do. Sorry, that was you heard that beeping. That was just my daughter calling. So sorry about that. But we're really, really thrilled that, for the longest time, there was no merchandise on Owen, because everything filtered through the WWE. And of course, you know, I refused to do anything with them and have any products with them. I don't want them to make a penny off of Owen. And, you know, I don't know if you're aware, but I had another issue with them where they were selling all of this tapes and things of Owen. And we actually, unfortunately, had another lawsuit against them that lasted 3 years where, you know, they were selling stuff behind my back. And so then, it just was left such a distaste. And I just never even entertained the thought of having merchandise of Owen, because I always was thinking it had to be linked with the WWE. So this is really great. And I didn't realize, how much wrestling has evolved, and that there are different companies that can produce things. And so anyway, that was all thanks to the Dark Side of the Ring and Vice Media, who we've worked together to create these commemorative Owen Hart t-shirts. And I'm really glad for the fans, because there hasn't been any merchandise and you know, for obvious reasons, but now we can change that, and we can at least let them have a t-shirt, and it's nice, because all the proceeds go to the Owen Hart Foundation, and the t-shirts are beautiful, and they all come with a certificate of authenticity, so you know that it's an official Owen Hart Foundation t-shirt. And it's really nice, because they can celebrate Owen, and they can know that all the proceeds are going to go to the Owen Hart Foundation, and that with that those funds we will do exceptional work in the community. So I think it's such a win-win. And like I said, you know, Owen loved his fans, and the fans were amazing to him. So it's really nice, because that was always the sad part for me, that the fans were left out in the cold, and there was really nothing I could do about it, because I just didn't want to work with the WWE and have them profit off of Owen's death. And so, yeah, I'm so excited. And I was so happy with Ryan, who runs the company. And they've just been so lovely to me, and they've created just the most beautiful t-shirts. I'm so pleased with them. So they've used our picture that we use from our Owen Hart Foundation of Owen, which is my favorite picture of Owen, actually. It's a painting, but it's from a real picture that of him, you know, in the ring, and so I don't know, it's just my favorite picture, and so I'm glad that people are going to be wearing it and helping us too. That's really nice.
Was there a situation, and I'm trying to remember, because again, this goes back 15, 20 years, and there's so many details of your legal battle that I remember, and one of them was Wasn't there some legal strategy involving royalties in the middle of that case where they wanted you to accept royalties as a way to somehow weaken your case? Am I remembering something wrong? Or something along those lines?
Yeah, they were. What they were doing, it wasn't royalties. They were sending checks. They were sending Owen's sort of paychecks. And in a way of like sort of weakening our case, like I never accepted any of the checks, but I think that was sort of like a strategy, right? That if I was accepting the wages, like kept taking the checks, that I can't remember exactly what the details were, but there was something to that effect that it would have been a negative for me to take out those checks because Owen had, he was gone already, you know, so, and I never took one of them. So, yeah, I know there were so many of these little details that were always trying to undercut me and undermine me. And, you know, it was just, yeah, it was such a terrible time. And, you know, and I'm so grateful. I know we kind of mentioned with my kids and everything, but, you know, I personally had the best mom who was so great to me, and my sister Virginia, who just were just pillars of, you know, strength and helped me too. So that's, you know, it's a blessing when you have solid people in your life.
You know, again, you were living a life, normal life, you know, your normal routine, and then this week comes up and you're doing a lot of media and it's bringing back all of these different memories and everything like that. I mean, how has this week been for you?
Yeah, it's been mixed emotions for sure. But at the same time, I'm really happy that, you know, like I said, it's a story that should have been told a long time ago. And, you know, for all those reasons that I gave earlier, it wasn't possible. And now I feel like people really are going to know the true story behind it. And I think they'll have a real understanding where I stand, why I've never wavered. I've always had my true convictions and just wasn't willing to budge, you know. And I think people will really know that now. They'll understand why. And I think they'll be supportive, and they'll see, you know, what really happened, and that's important. It's important to know the facts. And now let's move forward.
Were you surprised at all that WWE actually responded to some of the stuff? Because, I mean, I was taken aback just because of the timing of it. Not that it wouldn't happen at some point. But when it happened, I was like, whoa, I can't believe they're doing that this week.
I know. And that's where, too, I wasn't surprised, like I said, you know, in my response, that they would trot out their legal counsel, Jerry McDivitt, because it's really damning for the company, for people to hear this stuff. They've tried to keep a lid on it for a long time. And when people hear what actually happened, you know, it doesn't reflect well on the company. And also, too, as I mentioned, you know, Linda McMahon, she was the acting CEO at the time when Owen died. And, you know, she is has quite a few ties with President Donald Trump and his administration. So I'm sure they're not pleased about that either. But like I said, you know, the truth has always been my defense. And I'm not here to bash anybody. I'm not here to, you know, try to hurt anybody. But I'm really glad that finally my story could be told, because it never has been in this sort of platform. And I'm sure they're worried about the impact it will have.
When you were doing the suit, you know, one of the things that I guess was controversial, and this is from their end, was that when you did the suit, I guess, Lumar, you know, the people who made the the shackle, you did not, and they ended up, WWE ended up suing them, which was another unique aspect of the story, in the sense that WWE ended up getting, you know, pretty much most of their cost in a settlement from their insurance company. But you made the decision, you know, to sue WWE and not the shackle company, even the shackle company, you know, obviously. Yep. You know, I mean, WWE was, you know, it was their decision. Yep. All of those things that happened because of WWE. But
right.
The shackle, was also the thing that failed, so there is that aspect of it too. So, you know, was there any specific reason for this, or?
Yes. Well, okay. So, so when we, you know, embarked on the lawsuit, we did have Lumar. We were suing Lumar. We sued everybody. You know, you put everybody into the lawsuit. This
right.
is a
even city,
you know, what lawyers
city,
do.
You know, right. Yeah.
Yeah, they kind of like cover all the bases. And then once you start investigating, you let people out of the lawsuit. It's like, oh, okay, well, now we've kind of checked. And these guys, like, you know, there's no liability here. So you let them out. And so what was happening in the lawsuit was that was the process that, you know, we were learning, we were doing depositions, we were, you know, we deposed the riggers, we had affidavits from every top rigging company and person in the business. WWE had no one, not a single rigger would stand up on their behalf at all. They were 100% on our side. And so then as the process was going, like I mentioned, like the harness that they used for Owen, it wasn't meant for suspending people. It was meant for dragging people. So it wasn't that the harness had failed. It was inappropriate how they used it, but the harness itself didn't fail, right? Even though it was cutting off the circulation, like, because it wasn't meant for that purpose. And the Lumar clip is a sailboat clip. It's not meant for human use at all. It's a sailboat clip. It's sold on sailing sites. And so the clip itself didn't fail. It wasn't meant for humans to begin with. And then there was the ropes as well. So the company that designed the ropes as well. So there were three equipment manufacturers that were in our lawsuit. And as we went through, we decided that, you know what, none of these companies were at fault because their equipment was fine. It was just used inappropriately. The problem with Lumar was, like, unlike the other two manufacturers, they had $50 million of insurance money. And so when we let them out of the lawsuit, oh, that was just, you know, the WWE couldn't believe it because, you know, they were like, why would you let them out? They have all this insurance money. But what they didn't realize was that I didn't care about the money. I wouldn't have taken 1 cent from Lumar because they were not responsible for Owen's death. Their clip was meant for the sole use of sailboats. It was never meant to rig people, and they weren't guilty. So I let them out because I didn't want money. I was going to trial. I wanted, you know, accountability. I wanted the guilt to lie where it should, and it wasn't with Lumar. So then when WWE, when we settled our case, they went after Lumar for money, to reclaim some of the money. And Lumar settled with them, but they made sure that in the settlement that they took no responsibility for Owen's death. And the WWE agreed to that, so they didn't care, because all they care about is money, and that's all they cared about before, during, after, and to this day. So, you know, this is the story behind the, you know, all the equipment and the reason why we let them out and the reason why WWE went after them. They didn't go after the guys that made the harness. Why not? Because, you know what? They didn't have any money. So there was no insurance money with the harness company. There was no insurance money with the ropes company. They only cared about Lumar because they had insurance money.
When it comes to the city of Kansas City, did they ever explain to you, like, why they didn't just take over at that moment? You know, because, you know, like mm-hmm. you talked about on the show, and it's been talked about for 20 years, there was a death right there, and yeah. you know, this, you know, that, what, you know where I'm going, because you've talked about it already.
Well, you know, I don't know why, like, the police weren't called right away and that they didn't, like, shut everything down and investigate. But there was a criminal investigation after. And it wasn't that they didn't think that criminal charges couldn't be filed. They, you know, I talked to the prosecutor and, you know, as you know, taxpayers pay when trials happen. And so they just didn't feel like they had a high enough sort of percentage of conviction. Like they only take cases if they think they have a 90% rate of conviction, and they didn't think it quite met that bar. So that's why they weren't able to sort of prosecute on a criminal level, but that didn't affect our civil case at all. So, and it wasn't like they didn't think they weren't guilty of something. It was just that they didn't know if they could get a conviction.
Two things, Martha. One, to the fans listening right now, how would you like them to remember your husband? And two, what can fans do to honor the legacy and the memory of Owen Hart?
Well, you know, I'm happy that they came to know Owen as the wrestler. And I think what this whole episode has shown them is just the other side, behind the curtain, the man, and, you know, which was even better than the wrestling persona. So now I think they have the full picture. And so I would hope, you know, I always think give credit where it's due and remember him for the tremendous athlete that he was and the great wrestler that he was. And I encourage people to, you know, honor him and watch his matches and enjoy like all that, you know, the entertainment that he provided. But when you do, just remember that the person behind that persona was equally, if not more, amazing, and that he was really just the kindest person. And I told this story to Chris Jericho that, you know, Owen was always so philanthropic, and, you know, he supported a lot of charities. He was really involved with the Children's Hospital. He would go and visit terminally ill kids. He would go do speeches at schools. He supported Special Olympics, you know, so he was always doing sort of like organizational charitable events. But then he also just, you know, out of the blue, he was just always trying to help people no matter what it was. The guy broken down on the side of the road, pull over, help him change a tire, you know, push the car out of the way. Or if he just saw someone down and out, you know, he always willing to help. And there was one story that was just remarkable that he was checking out of his hotel and he saw this homeless guy, and he'd had the room, like he was going to have the room for like until the next day or something like that. I don't know how it worked, but he went to the guy and he said, listen, here's my room key. Go have a, you know, use my room. Go have a shower, have a good sleep in the bed. There's pizza in the fridge. Just don't break anything, you know? So he gave him his room, and those were the kinds of things that he would do. And the other thing too, you know, I think why, even though he wasn't like a lot of the wrestlers, like he wasn't a drinker, and he just was different, you know, but I think they loved him so much because he didn't care, you know, he was just so accepting of everybody. He just accepted people at face value. He never judged anybody. It was like, you know, live your life how you want to. This is how I live my life. Accept me and I accept you too. He just was always trying to lead by example and, you know, but like accepted everybody just at face value. So they never felt like he judged them or, you know, it just wasn't like that. He was just accepting and helpful. Like if he could help you, he would help you. And even one time I remember, you know, someone really like did something wrong to him. And then he went and he got their kids tickets to the show or something. And I said to him, you know, why would you do that? Because, you know, wasn't that guy just terrible to you? And he said, yeah, I know. He said, but you know, it's not the kid's fault. And so, like, that was just like, he was so wise, you know, and he could just see, he was so reflective and he could see things that other people couldn't see. And he always found the value somehow in people and just always was spinning things to the good, you know, which was something that, a gift that he left for me too. And so that's what I hope people remember, and they can honor him. Like I said, like enjoy his matches. And if you want to help the foundation, you know, all donations get a tax receipt. And if you want to buy a t-shirt and celebrate Owen along with us in this episode and know the truth, what really happened, and know that all the proceeds are going to the Owen Hart Foundation, all for the good. And then that's how you can celebrate them. And that's sort of my motto, you know, in life is like everything for the good. So not that everything that happens to you in life is good, but just try to find the good in what happens to you and leave the rest.
Martha, I want to thank you so much for this.
Is there a social platform where fans can connect with the Owen Hart Foundation?
We have our Owen Hart Foundation website. We also have Facebook, we have Twitter, we have Instagram, and then of course I have my movie blog, and I do try my best to respond, and you know, like people just need to give me a bit of time to catch up, but you know, they can reach out, and there's lots of platforms and social media where they can reach us and send us their, you know, their comments or whatever they want to do, and that would be lovely.
Dave and Brian will be back tonight with another Wrestling Observer Radio. Dr. Martha Hart, thank you so much for your time and being so generous.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.